We were established in 1988, July 15th. You know, it is a strange irony that I also joined CSIR service on the same day, in the same year. So my journey with CSIR also, it's kind of, I'm destined to be associated with this institution, started the day this institute was founded. So it was founded as a CSIR Center for Mathematical Modeling and Computer Simulation. You know, that time, basically, that was the in thing. So they wanted this as a small center. It was not an institute. It was just a center which is supposed to be located in Bangalore, which is supposed to help the CSIR labs on computational and mathematical modeling. So that is how it was established. Then when this big data started developing, so in 2013, it was decided by headquarters that we should be repositioned as Fourth Paradigm Institute to basically put CSIR on the map of big data science. So that is how we have become Fourth Paradigm Institute. Currently, we are actually a very small group of 23 scientists, including me. And we have some support staff. But I am very proud to say that though our strength is so less, our scientists received several prestigious national and state and young scientists awards. Like we have Bhatnagar, we have National Mineral Award, we have National Geoscience Awardee. Then we have two CSIR Young Scientist Awards, one NINSA Young Scientist Award, and several other state and several other awards. So that way, for the strength of 23 scientists, that's a huge achievement. So that itself speaks about our institute and our work. And the kind of citations, global citations we get of our work is basically a testimony to the global relevance of our research work in the area of disaster management. So with this, I will just share my PPT. I have few slides. It just gives a glimpse of what are the scientific activities that we are doing. It won't take more than 5 minutes. So I'll share screen now. Yeah, now you can see now. So this first slide basically gives a bit of a glimpse of our work in disaster management. As you can see, this slide gives the seismic risk for Indian subcontinent. And, you know, it basically says what is the individual vulnerability in proportion with the population density. So you can see, like, you know, where you don't have much population density, the vulnerability is less for the disaster, whereas it is more. So, and then there are also two figures on the left and right, which basically show that our models give 48-hour lead for thunderstorm predictions. It is one of the example, and 72-hour lead for extreme temperature prediction in Odisha. And the center one, see, we are known for our computing facilities. We host super high performance computing for CSIR as a whole, that is hosted at CSIR Fourth Paradigm Institute. So with this, okay, now that why we are we called, since it is a popular talk, so I thought I will just explain why we are called as a fourth paradigm. So for that, we have to go through all the four paradigms of science. So the first paradigm of science is when we do experiments and come out with empirical relations. Then the second paradigm of science is when we apply this and write equation and solve them analytically, that becomes our second paradigm of science. Then the third paradigm is when you are in the, because of the advent of the computers and all, when you solve this equation using numerical methods and modeling, that becomes the third paradigm. So we were established as a third paradigm institute, that is Center for Mathematical Modeling and Computer Simulation, and then we repositioned to fourth paradigm, that is data intensive scientific discovery. It is nothing but big data science. So this is our future now, and we got repositioned in 2013. So since we, as I've already told you, we are our staff, scientist strength is very less, and we have two verticals. One vertical which works in earth and engineering sciences, and other one is data science and supercomputing. So under the earth and engineering sciences, I just thought I'll put this figure because this is the seismic activity in Indian subcontinent. This is what we have plotted. Our scientists have plotted, taking all available seismic data from research papers, from catalogs, everything. So this is one of a kind of figure. Then you can see what is the seismic vulnerability of the Indian continent. and under the sorry under the data science and supercomputing, we hosted one of the best supercomputing facilities for CSIR, which we are now going to upgrade it to 2.5 petaflops with basically enhanced AI workload. And then recently we have been given a 1.2 petaflop system by AMD for basically for dedicated COVID-19 research for the next 2 years. So that is also hosted at CSIR Fourth Paradigm Institute. And then we have scientists working in cybersecurity, AI and ML. So that AI and ML one presentation we are going to have today in this webinar. So coming to our seismic hazard work, this is the size. We were the first to give the seismic hazard map for Indian subcontinent way back in 2003, which we later on refined to a resolution of 0.2 to 0.2 degree and gave a neo-deterministic seismic hazard map. Basically, what this means is the input for this map will be your models, then seismogenic zones, and then focal mechanism, and all sorts of seismic catalysts, and we take all possible seismic sources to calculate the ground acceleration. Then based on this and modeling, we give the ground acceleration. So this is how it is. So as you can see, your high risk is basically the ones which are in maroon and red, that is your North India, Northeast India, Bhuj, and some places in plate interior, and the rest is low risk. So this acceleration goes as a direct, we have communicated it to Bureau of Indian Standards to remodify their design for the buildings based on this map and the acceleration we have given. So that this has been communicated also for research and also for the Bureau of Indian Standards. Then next comes the our seismic hazard work, where we use GPS. As you all know, all of you use GPS in your mobile, so there's no need to do it. So we started this work when GPS became fully operational in 1994. That is when we started this work at this institute. And all this map basically shows all the observation network stations. See, all these triangles, they work 24/7, 365 days a year. They collect data from GPS satellites. And the rest of that small brown circles you have are episodic measurements. And then with this data and by using analysis, we get basically how much on the surface we are moving. Like I will say, I am moving, Bangalore is moving at 5 cm per year. Whereas, you know, Kirit Kumar, who's sitting in Almora, is moving around 3 cm per year. So it measures so precisely. These are called precise, not the GPS in your mobile. We use precise instrument, but they are based on GPS technology, which measures this. So the violet arrows which you're seeing are basically the average vectors we have put. But otherwise, we get each velocity vector on each of these stations which we have. So what we do here is, like for Port Blair, for example, Port Blair is there. We had an earthquake in 2004, Sumatra earthquake. So if you have measurements before and after the earthquake, basically it gives us how much those islands have moved due to the earthquake. So we captured a motion of 1 to 6 meters. You can see the green arrow here because of the earthquake. Then we use this motion to find out what is that below the earth, what is the slip on the faults or rupture zones below the earth, which caused this kind of deformation on the surface. For this, we use inverse models. So using inverse models, we have given actually slip along the main Himalayan fault. What is the slip that is right now happening, active slip, and which of the fault is slipping and how it is slipping at what depth. We also give this, because we have a displacement, surface displacement, we give strain. And this strain, we basically combine it with the seismic strain, which we get from the focal mechanism solution of all the earthquakes that have happened since past 700 years. And then we give, this is the magnitude of earthquake and this is the recurrence interval. So recently for Kashmir, we have given that the magnitude of the earthquake will be around 7.7 is due with a recurrence interval of some 700 years. So that is the kind of study we do using this. So we give that. This is one of our other premier activities. Then the under disaster management, the other very major activity where most of our scientists are involved is climate change and its impact. So we have very good expertise in this area where our scientists do global climate simulations, specifically to study the Indian monsoon. So they take the input of aerosol effect, deep convection in the global climate models, and then they come out with a specificity how the Indian monsoon process. And they also, our scientists here also worked on ultra high resolution climate models for taking IPCC global warming scenarios. And they've also came out with, see, if you want to apply climate to impact studies, how it impacts agriculture or hydrology or epidemics, what we do is they downscale the climate framework to 1 kilometer resolution and then use that parameters to study its impact on agriculture, hydrology and epidemics. So this is one of the things which you are seeing is our malaria model, which gives a very accurate early warning of malaria risk. Because for this, as I've said earlier, you need all this rainfall, temperature, humidity, wind for that area very precisely, which we get through our models. And then we use it to simulate this one. So this is one of the applications of impact of climate change on malaria. Rest of it, Rakesh will talk. Then we go to carbon flux estimation. That is what now everyone talks about, carbon credits. You have to, you should not, you should contribute to carbon credits and all that. So we are the, this is one thing where we, I can say that we are the only group in the country which is working on both carbon dioxide measurement and inverse modeling to estimate the carbon fluxes. So as you can see, these are our GHG stations. GHG stands for greenhouse gas station. So they measure greenhouse gas. So this is our station in Hanle, which was set up in sometime in 19, I think in 2000. Then we have a reference station at Hoskote. That is one of unique station in India. And then we have two more stations in Pondicherry and Port Blair, where we do flask sampling. And this is our Hanle station, the picture you can see. And this is our data, seasonal variation of CO2 measurements at Pondicherry from 2012 to 2020. So you can see what rate carbon emissions are increasing. And this is basically what we, using this data, we do inverse modeling to find out what is the net carbon flux, land flux. So this was run for the year. So as you can see, all these red areas, red and yellow, are all carbon sources. And I think from zero, no, so green, blue, violet, these are all sinks. So you can easily see who's contributing maximum to carbon emissions. So this is the, and we, all our stations are WMO standard, and this work is really one of its kind in our country. Then we have ocean modeling. In ocean modeling also, we do basically carbon sources and sinks in even in ocean. So we are the first, we started earlier, way back in, I think in around 2000, maybe a little earlier to that. First time 3D, three-dimensional physical, chemical, biological coupled models we have done. And then we were the first to give annual primary productivity. So this is our simulated one using these models, which matches very well with the observed one. So this is a, and we proposed a fundamental relation for the ammonia inhibition on nitrate uptake. And this figure is very interesting for four seasons, where we have given the difference between the CO2 at the surface using that physical, chemical, biological coupled model, and then removing biology and only using physical, chemical coupled model. So you can very clearly see the role of biology, and you can see that along the coast where you have maximum primary productivity, you have, they actually absorb carbon. So kind of, so that you can very clearly see in all the seasons, in all the four pictures. So this is the carbon cycle in ocean. This is our cybersecurity test bed, which is one of its kind again in the country. And recently, this was established in 2015. Recently, with the project from MIT, we have put network telescope deployment. And then this figure which you see is 1 week of malicious connections, 1 week of malicious connections that are captured by this test bed. So each red dot is basically a cluster of computers, which either are used for malicious attacks, or they directly are involved in malicious attacks. So using this data, we do research on that. So this is our cybersecurity research, and the other one is which we have done with Cognizant. So this is basically the vehicular test beds. Like in abroad and all, they have this thing all in place. VANET it is called. What they do for basically efficiency in the transport, how the managing transport vehicles on the road, efficiency of it, and to reduce the accident risk. So that this is already there available in globally. In India, it is not available. So this is the test bed which we have in our institute, and this is the kind of networks with security and privacy networks we do. We also work on several other things in cybersecurity and AI and ML research. And thank you so much for your patience.